we as magazine publishers live on niches. There is nothing that we would do which newspapers can do better, which is giving news every day, taking PTI or Reuters and publishing it every day. We love discovering very targeted niches, targeted audiences, targeted advertisers, and the stuff. And we always keep looking at what newspaper publishers cannot do or will not do. When newspaper publishers don't do what they can do better, then magazine publishers will come in, thrive, and prosper. You fail, we succeed. Newspapers fail, magazines succeed. Talking about niche publishing, one of the biggest things that we always felt when we work for a niche publication in Outlook is, how convinced are we that that publication is going to serve reader interests? How convinced are we that the editor, when he goes out into the market, says, this publication is edited by me? The marketeer, the salesperson, everyone should be so proud of the publication that they would say, they would go and sell it out of their hearts and not just out of their minds. You know, it's important to have audiences, it's important to have readership, it's important to have circulation. But most importantly, for all the people who are involved with the product, with the creation of the product, can they proudly go and lay a claim that they are a part of a team which produces that magazine or that niche publication? If you don't crack that well, if you don't have editors claiming that they also publish a supplement or a niche publication which goes with the newspaper, then you have a losing proposition. If the editor of the main newspaper, and here I'm talking about newspapers, you have so many supplements and so many niche publications that are going, which you define as supplements, and for the purpose of this presentation, we call it as niche publication, then it's meaningless for you to get into a niche publication where your editor would not be able to own up to the content. I've heard for some time these days this talk that my main newspaper is untouched by what my supplement does. It, over a longer period of time, is a failed philosophy. That is my belief. Maybe I'll stand wrong 10 years down the line, or maybe they'll stand wrong 10 years down the line. But my belief is that what you have in your main publication, the editorial ethos, the journalistic ethos, the credibility, the focus towards the reader, should translate to everything that the publication offers, which goes along with the publication, come what may. And at times, even advertisements. When you know that an ad is lying, would you stand up and say, I would not take the ad? So these are very important things as you move along, because for niche publications, you will only have niche advertising, which might lead, mislead, or wrongly advise people. So it's very important for you to control the kind of content that comes in niche publications, whatever name you call it, whether it's a supplement or whether it's a publication on its own. The other thing, as I said, how much of a control do your people have on the content as compared to the kind of control that advertisers have on your control? So these are things I'll talk to you as I move along. And most importantly, I think one of the things that we do is we don't put our money where our mouth is, because we definitely have a job to ensure that we are market timing the product. But we cannot market dictated by the market about the product. Like, for example, we come up with a supplement in every September or every March which says summer travel. I've seen many publications which announce summer travel for March, but when they're not money advertisers, they pull out. That is no conviction. When you know that in March I'm going to do a summer travel supplement, you need to announce it today so that your marketing, your sales team has enough chance to go and actually sell it. And also as you move along, ensure that the publication comes out whatever the market conditions are. You're timing it to the market, but you cannot have market dictating the kind of content or whether you want to do it or not do it. So that's very important as we move along. When you work on niche publications, you must know that the emotional bond that you have with your reader is much stronger than what you would have for many other things. Because you are having a filtered audience which just reads that for that magazine and then moves out. So every decision that you take when you're working on a niche publication is to ensure that the reader's heart and soul is with you, not just his mind. In fact, when the 26/11 happened in Bombay in 2008, we carried this cover story with the Bombay thing. Obviously, there was no escaping that thing. Because we are seen as also a glossy magazine, we requested advertisers to pull out all advertisements. That is one issue in the history of this country which, by desire, on purpose, did not carry a single ad in the magazine. We didn't want to carry the ads. And you know what? It brought us much, much closer to our audiences and advertisers at the same time. If I look at my overall year for that year, I wouldn't have lost a single page, because all these advertisers came back to us saying, boss, can I, you know, have that one page extra coming for the third issue or the fourth issue? Not a single page was lost. And each reader that we had respected us for what we did. Because I didn't want to suddenly from pop out of the magazine, come out and say how you can be fair, or how high your hair can be silky smooth. It is very bad for the magazine. I'll take page 80, you'll still have an ad. Page 90, you'll still have an ad. You get my point, what I'm saying? This is page, whatever, page 131. You still have an ad. So with all the convictions that we have only gained. We've not lost anything in the process, because we believe that a reader would, once a reader comes to us and starts respecting us, there is no option for the advertiser but to come to you. The advertiser is not coming because you suck up to him. I'm sorry. The advertiser comes to you because he believes that the reader is there with you. He'll only come once or twice when you actually give in to him or submit to him. He won't come to you forever if you were to do it, because if that were to be the case, many of the newspapers who sell journalism space should be the most prosperous ones. They're not. And across the thing, you know, I ask many people this question. You know, people, you go and lamb a politician who takes a bribe, but you don't lamb an advertiser who takes a bribe, or who cheats students, or who cheats shareholders, or whatever it is. So there is something which is a huge gap between what we practice and we preach. But if you were to keep the reader as the cornerstone of our success, then you would have these kind of things working better for you. Now, these are the learnings. Make the plan with the reader in mind, not the advertiser. The advertiser will follow if you have the reader with you. Develop journalistic expertise even in niches. If you don't have that expertise and you have someone who is covering sports also going and interviewing Kareena Kapoor, you will have a serious problem out here. Most importantly, don't treat niche as a supplement. You know, some of them are being very charitable, very pathetic. So my request to all of you is just ensure that don't treat it as a supplement. Treat it as a main product. Impose the same guidelines, same ethos that you would have for the main product, and let it translate to everything else. I remember Wall Street Journal does this very, very well. It says, my magazine is as good as the main product. And they say the same probity, the same depth, the same incisiveness would be there in my magazine, which is a niche publication which comes free with the newspaper, as the main newspaper would be. So you can believe in that word of the niche publication or a supplement as much as you can believe in the main newspaper itself. These are questions to be answered, because ultimately with all these principles that we're talking about long term, we need to be alive in the short term to be fighting the long term. You know, we are not jihadis. We fight we live to fight another day. How much is the incremental revenue? Obviously, these are all simple questions. Is there incremental readership coming in? And this is very important, because Sunday Telegraph did not have women audiences. So what they did was they created a food supplement. This readership went up by 7%. Suddenly they had women at home. You know, Sunday Telegraph goes everywhere, but suddenly you had women also reading it because of the food supplement. The other thing is, you know, and I'll show you some examples as I move along. Do you have new advertisers coming in because of that niche publication? If you have new advertisers coming in which were not coming in the mainstream publication till then you have a great opportunity here. So you're also trying to expand the universe of advertisers that you already have. A few international examples. How to Spend It is a publication that comes from Financial Times. It comes 24 times a year, which means once a fortnight. It is awarded the Magazine of the Year in 2004 by every single presentation that happened in that country, in UK or US or wherever it was. It was awarded the Magazine of the Year. It's not a niche publication of the year. It's going free, mind you. And you had people like Vogue and Condé Nast Traveler and all fighting to get that award. And How to Spend It won the Magazine of the Year award. It is because they actually put in a lot of resources behind it. It's not just another supplement for them. It's not just another niche publication. They want to own it. They want to be proud of what they've created. And you must look at the kind of advertising that they have. Since they launched, the luxury advertising increased by 84% in Financial Times. In 4 years flat. It was launched sometime in 2004. But by 2008, the luxury advertising increased by 84%. In European terms, this is huge and unparalleled. A lot of people in UK buy this weekend supplement, Weekend Financial Times, only because How to Spend It is there as a part of the whole thing. So they actually managed to have these people who read Financial Times during the weekday for all the financial news, buy Financial Times even during the weekend, get advertising which was not existent, ensure that the circulation is pretty stable even during the weekends, and get all these advertisers coming in. And that is a winning formula for most of us.